Back everybody. So in this talk, I will tell you a few things about how to use polymer physics in order to understand chromosome organization inside the nuclei of the cells. So this is now a very developing topic, and there are many research group working on this. So before moving to the specific subject, I just want to tell you a few things about polymers for those of you that you know too much about that. So of course, I mean, polymers are central in, in soft matter theories, and are also object of very extensive computational modeling, so which is probably almost of a great interest for this workshop. So polymers are, what are polymers? Polymers are big molecules which are made of many repeating units. Each one of these repeating units is called generically monomers. And because of these chain reaction, which is called the polymerization, you get from one single unit, through this chain reaction, a very big molecules. And in principle, this chain reaction can go on forever. So in the end, you have molecules composed of many single of these repeating units. Okay, so polymers, depending on the on the constituents, they can be relatively simple, like polyethylene, like where you have, a single repeating units, which is ethylene, which repeats its many times, or it can be more complicated. Okay, and here you have examples of more complicated polymers that exist in more complex architecture, like for instance, alternating copolymer, where you have, repeating units like A, B, A, B, A, B, etc. Or they can, the ordering of these constituent units can be just random, can be organized in block, and they can also be, more complicated, not just linear, but they can be like branched or circular. Not example of this, but they can be exist in many architectures. So it's very complicated. The kind of architecture you can have in polymer domain. Then polymers can exist also in different states. So you can have a gas of polymer, for instance, or you can have a liquid of polymer, like in semi-dilute solution or melt, and they can be solid. Okay, for instance, the main constituents of the tires, of cars, are made of polymer, which are cross-linked in such a way that you keep the structure together, like in a solid, although they are not really solid in the sense that there is no really long range order in that, but they can be considered solid in the sense that they have elasticity or things like that. So now to our concern, specifically for this workshop, there exist of course biopolymers, and biopolymers are of these three different kinds, let's say. There exist proteins which you will heard about, in other talks, more about proteins. There exist nucleic acids, and nucleic acids are more, I will tell you a few things about nucleic acids in this, during this talk. And there exists chromatin, okay? Chromatin is basically the basic constituent of chromosomes. And let's say it comes out of DNA plus constituent proteins. And these constituent proteins are necessary in order to fold the DNA inside the cells. But all of these, besides being biopolymers, they are polymer in nature. So they share many of features that the normal the normal polymers that I told you before. So now, one essential feature of polymer is that because you have small fluctuation, between the orientation of the monomers that constitute the chain, it happens that polymers do not exist typically in one single conformation, okay? But you have many. Actually, it was realized long ago that the number of this conformation is high, exponentially high in the number of monomers. So that means that, and it was the basic ideas formulated in the, I mean, from the 30s to the 60s by, I mean, all these bunch of outstanding people, that basically you can treat polymer physics like statistical mechanical problem, okay? And that was, what I mean, the fundamental idea that was, of course, developed by many of these people, but earned, I mean, basically earned Flory a Nobel Prize in chemistry, where he applied the statistical mechanical ideas to study the polymer problem. And there were other developments from the 60s to the 90s where more advanced concepts were applied, like correlations, entanglements, that were developed especially in the works by Sam Edwards, Pierre-Gilles Dejean, and de Cloisot. And they were so important, I mean, the contribution that earned, I mean, Pierre-Gilles Dejean a Nobel Prize in physics now for applying statistical physics concept to the study of polymer conformation. So it's a very, it's a very important subject, I mean, in soft matter. So now there are many models, I mean, that you can derive from statistical mechanics in order to understand the polymer properties. The fundamental model is the ideal polymer model. By ideal, I mean that what it happens that you, I mean, this is as fundamental as the ideal gas model in statistical mechanics, in the sense that you completely neglect interaction between the different monomers, and you treat polymers as a string, a chain of beads, a chain of links, and these links can take any random orientation in space. So, I mean, this is a relatively simple problem to treat. And then if you use these formulas, you understand that basically the typical chain conformation for a polymer is to be the same over a random walk. So this, if you neglect interaction between the monomers. There are more complicated, relatively more complicated models that you can introduce. For instance, the freely rotating chain. But the important thing of this model is that you are neglecting interaction. So in the end, you always end up with a linear relationship between the typical chain size, the typical square chain size, and the number of monomers. Okay, so this is relatively, so this is a strict law that you can derive from this model. Well, a typical feature of polymers that they obey scale invariance, in the sense that they are fractals, which means that a single part of a polymer looks like the whole part. So, and because of polymers, because polymers obey scale invariance, before saying that, I have to tell you that if you start introducing exclusive volume in your model, so things become rapidly more complicated. And of course, this is a necessary ingredient if you want to understand the properties of real polymers, because of course, I mean, two monomers cannot occupy the same portion of space. And immediately, you end up with a scaling, namely with you end up with a relationship between the typical chain size versus the total number of constituents that does not longer respect the random walk law, but is a bit larger than that. So that effect was highlighted by Flory, and who also realized that basically the properties of polymer do not, the large scale properties do not depend really on the specific interaction of between the constituents, but it depends on a very few essential parameters, okay? And in this sense, you can apply, if you, let's say, renormalize this interaction, you can apply the same tools of coarse grading renormalization group. And basically, you can use the same tools of some typical tools that were derived in statistical physics to derive the properties of polymer. That was done in many works in the 60s to the 70s by especially by Pierre-Gilles Dejean and Sam Edwards. Okay, that derived a very full, complete understanding of the properties of real chain. This was a very, super fast introduction. So, of course, it cannot be exhaustive, but this is somehow necessary to understand a bit on the properties of chromosome folding and where you can apply or you can use polymer physics in order to understand how chromosome folds inside the nuclei of the cell. Sorry. So what is basically the problem of chromosome folding? Okay. So first of all, what are chromosomes? As I said, DNA is a special polymer, okay? So in sense that, of course, it's very important, but it's a special polymer. It's made of a sequence of the famous sequence of G, T, C, and A, and it's very long. So it's typical. So for instance, if you think about the humans, so we have a single filament of DNA per single chromosome is made of about 100 million bases, okay? And so this long sequence is wrapped around specific proteins. These proteins are called histones. And so then they form a structure which is called the 10 nanometer fiber. So the reason why it's called the 10 nanometer fiber is because the diameter of the compound between DNA and this wrapping histone is the size of about 10 nanometers. And then it was observed that under physiological condition, although this part is a bit debated, these 10 nanometer fibers fold into a coarser fiber, if you want, and of the diameter, which is about 30 nanometer. So because of that, this folding is called the 30 nanometer fiber. Okay. So then what exists between the 30 nanometer fiber to the, let's say, the large scale folding of chromosome is completely unknown. So today we know many things about that, how it works, but we don't know anything. We don't have the complete picture. So basically all this realm here is needs to be explored. And this is where I'm trying to tell you that where polymer physics can be useful. Hmm? At least to say to predict something and to tell something which possibly is non-trivial. So this is the kind of things that you find in most biological textbooks. But what was done during the past years about the work on chromosomes? So it was one of the first important discoveries in the field was realized by these two German scientists, Karl Rabl and Theodor Boveri, who realized that, made a very important discovery in the late 50s of the 19th century. So notice that was much before that, than the discovery of DNA was realized. So at that time, probably was just a curiosity. So what they found that chromosomes were not just randomly organized inside the cell, but they can be found in specific portions of the nucleus, okay? And they made, so these are pictures of the works, I think, of Theodor Boveri, who made the pictures of chromosomes inside the nuclei of the cell. So he really observed that. And he said that, he noticed that these chromosomes are not randomly organized, but they obey certain patterns. Okay, so now at the time, as I said, this was some kind of a curiosity, because at the time they didn't know too much about about genetics or about this kind of stuff. Then much later, actually, in the 70s, I think, these two German scientists, actually two brothers, Thomas Kremer and Christoph Kremer, they made a very clever experiment. So what they did the following. They have some cells, actually nuclei of some cells, and they started, they used the laser beam to destroy the nuclear contact of these cells. Okay, so they beamed the chromosomes. And then they said, they made the following hypothesis. They said, okay, if chromosomes, I have many chromosomes, they look like this way, like a spaghetti ball. So then the damage that I create to chromosomes should be, randomly distributed across all the chromosomes. Okay. I mean, because sometimes I, let's say I kill chromosome one, I destroy actually chromosome one, sometimes chromosome two, on average, I would destroy all of them in some pieces. Actually, it's not what they found. Huh? They found that damages were really localized to some chromosome and not to the others. Okay, like the fact that I use the laser beam, I can touch only one chromosome and not the others. And so this is only, let's say, compatible with the hypothesis that chromosomes were localized into a specific portion of the nucleus. Okay, and they should be, let's say, confined to regions which are smaller than the total size of the nucleus. Okay, so that was some kind of indirect observation. But it came out more recently, always by the same people, that used a very clever technique, which is called fluorescence in situ hybridization, which is a technique that allows you to color chromosome, each single chromosome inside your favorite cell, with some specific probe, and then to see it. Mm? And this is a picture, for instance, of a chicken fibroblast. So each color here identifies a single chromosome. And this picture shows beautifully that each chromosome is localized to a specific portion of the nucleus. So it's not like spread around, okay? It occupies a specific region. So imagine that this is sort of a picture of the world. So each chromosome is like a country, okay? And the borders between chromosomes are pretty neat with some intermingling between them, but otherwise you can really identify a chromosome. So now this picture is called this theory is called the hypothesis of chromosome territoriali. Today is very well accepted, and it's very general in the sense that all, let's say, superior all organisms, provided that the chromosomes are long enough, they show territories, even humans. Hmm? Human mice, I mean, in mammals, this is very typical, let's say. And it holds for all cells. It's not just like in a specific cell line, it holds in all cells. Okay, so it's a general feature. So now it's so general, actually, they start, wondering if it's, if it has any biological meaning, the chromosome territories hypothesis. And in fact, they show that basically the way chromosomes, they form territories, but the territories, they have also some randomness, but actually this randomness is related to how the specific cell line works. So for instance, they found that in some cells chromosomes were found close to the gene, chromosomes were found close to the cell sender, and in other cells were found close, the same chromosome were found close to the nuclear periphery. Mm? And this seems to correlate with the functionality of the cell. I mean, how certain genes are expressed and how certain genes are repressed. And in this very beautiful work, they finally were able to show that in the same cell line, which is the Rod photoreceptors, so the distribution of, of the chromatin material is inverted according to the fact that if the mammal, the cystic mammal is a diurnal mammal or is a nocturnal mammal. Huh? So meaning that the chromosome organization is completely reversed between the two. And this, according to me, it shows that, how beautiful somehow evolution works, that you have evolution pressure on your chromosome distribution inside the cells, and that also has an implication for the functionality of the specific cell. Okay, so later on, I think I'm concluding with this biological introduction. There were other developments, in particular, one of the most important ones, is called chromosome conformation capture. So this is a relatively recent technique developed in the lab of Job Decker in the United States and defined by many other groups, especially the group of Bingren at the University of California, San Diego, those people have invented a protocol which allows you to probe chromosome contacts inside the cells. Why are so important chromosome contacts? Are important because, people believe that whenever the different chromosome come into contact, these contacts are related to the fact that some genes are expressed and some genes are repressed, okay? And so these maps, these heat maps here, tell you how certain sequence along the genomes interact with the corresponding sequence on the same chromosome, okay? And so now you have all these contact maps you can find for many, many, many different organisms. They show many features, they have many features in common across the organisms, but they also display differences, and you can quantify these differences. And according to these differences, you are able also to correlate the intensity of this map to specific properties of the genome. Okay, so this is a very important field that currently under development, strong development. And also by the studying these maps, you can tell something about how chromosomes fold inside the cells. What is their shape, or you can reconstruct their shape starting from these matrices. So now, after this maybe strong introduction on polymers and the chromosome folding problem, I tell you a few things how you can use polymer physics consideration in order to understand how polymers are packed, how chromosomes are packed inside the nucleus of the cell. Okay, the first important consideration one has to do is the fact that we focus on human cells because it's the ones that are more familiar to us, of course. And so think that each human cell contains about about 6 billion base pair of DNA, which, if you stretch them from end to end, it's about 2 meters of DNA folded inside each one of our cell, okay? And this DNA occupies a very narrow region, a region of about 10 microns, okay? So it's 5 order of magnitude less than the total length of the DNA inside the cell, okay? And so, of course, if you make the proportion, this is like putting a rope of about 100 kilometers inside a backpack, okay? And so the question is this DNA stays inside the nucleus because otherwise we wouldn't work, but the question is how you can put all these, immense rope inside the narrow space in an efficient manner, or how it would look like if you use a microscope, or how you should expect that should work, inside such a narrow space. So, okay, this is an astronomical comparison. This is the same. So if the nucleus is the Earth, it's the same distance of the for DNA like the center of the Sun to Uranus. So it's a huge difference in length scale. So, in order to understand the problem, or to focus on the problem, we have DNA which has all this structure, and we have to think a bit. How the cell works. So you have basically two stages during the cell cycle. And these two stages are, one is mitosis and the other is interphase. So mitosis is the part of the cell cycle where chromosomes have this, familiar rod-like shape. At the end of each mitosis stage, the DNA, which has this shape of each chromosome, starts to swell inside the nucleus and occupies its own territory, as I said. So this is a typical picture of this is the nucleus, okay? And so this is one single chromosome, and each color here is one of those, okay? And so the question is what it happens here at the end of the mitosis when cell enter interphase? And is it possible to, is it possible to say something here at this point, by using let's say, simple physical concept. So this is basically what motivated me and my collaborators now, a bit slightly more than 10 years ago, where we developed a model, a polymer physics model, a computational model, in trying to somehow understand the formation of chromosome territories. No? Because at the time people, well, let's say the idea was to use a simple physical model in order to understand a bit the physics of this object and try to also give a possible physical explanation for the presence of, for the formation of these territories. Because we thought maybe since these motifs, these territories are spread, I mean, are general, you can find in all the cells of the organisms, that should be maybe also a simple physical mechanism that can originate them. So what we did, basically, we did exactly what it's here. So we simulated the decondensation of chromosomes, let's say, at the end of the mitosis when entering interphase. In order to do that, we constructed, let's say, model mitotic chromosomes. Each one is basically a big polymer. So each one was made of about 30,000 monomer particle. Each one of these model particles is a homopolymer, so there is no sequence information, nothing. It's very simple model, let's say. It's a kind of model that you have in, let's say, in any polymer solution, any polymer mesh, okay? We arranged four of this chain in order to keep the simulation doable. Inside the simulation box with the periodic boundary condition. And so we did some, as I said, we did some coarse graining in the sense that, so DNA, so we intended to model mammalian cells. So each, so the typical mammalian genome is the human one. Each chromosome is very long, so you cannot model things, let's say, at the DNA scale. You have to do something coarser. But as I said, I mean, coarse graining is a typical technique that you apply in polymer physics, so that things maybe is not so dramatic. So just to give you an overview of the scale, so here each monomer means that we are modeling chromosome at a scale which is compatible with the 30 nanometer fiber. So namely, each monomer here is about three kilobase pair. So it's a coarser model, okay? And then we used Brownian dynamics to simulate these objects. So for those of you who are not familiar with Brownian dynamics, this is basically like numerical integration of, let's say, of Langevin equation. Okay, so here, each monomer has some friction, Newtonian forces between the monomers plus some noise, okay? And the noise respects the standard relationship for Gaussian noise. So it's very simple. Mm? And the rationale to use Brownian dynamics is because the chromosome live in a, let's say, kind of aqueous environment. So they are also subject to some random noise. So this model should work quite okay. So if you want this modeling is like saying that chromosomes are a semi-dilute solution of polymer chains, okay? And the interaction we used to model, so the Newtonian interaction between the monomers are simple, in the sense that they are simple and minimal. So you have only chain connectivity. So basically two monomers which are close along the chain cannot be separated. So you have some stiffness between along the chain in order to cope with some biological measurement of chromosomes. Then you have to do some mapping in order to model with real let's say to map this into real biological problems. So the sides of the simulation box were chosen in such a way that the density of our polymer is compatible with the natural DNA density. And then, this is a very important ingredient, you have hardcore repulsion between monomers. Namely, this means that whenever this thing during the course of simulation, I mean, each monomer encounter another monomer in his, let's say, random displacement, cannot cross each other. I will bump and then we'll go back. Okay, so this is actually this is a very important ingredient. So if you apply that and you let the simulation go, you at the end of the simulation you end up with something like this. So the your chains open, and after some random displacement, they get stuck into some of this conformation. Okay, in this conformation, so I've used different color for each polymer. Actually, the result is that they strongly resemble territories in the sense that they also occupy specific region of the, let's say, of the cell, of the simulation cell, without mixing, without liking to mixing with the other, with the other polymer. And so because you have done a molecular dynamic simulation, you can track also let's say the mean square displacement, the random mean square displacement of each one of these bead, and you can compare to the experimental results. So this was a comparison between our simulation and let's say experiments on the mean square displacement of real genomic loci. This allows you to basically to fix the let's say the diffusion coefficient of your simulation. I will tell you a bit now, I don't have the time to really spend this, but I will tell you a bit more details if you're interested during this question and answer session this afternoon. But I want to just give you an overview of what you can measure, because this is quite important. So you can now compare the structure of your chains, of your simulated chain, to experiments for chromosome. And here I'm going to give a bit more detail on this. So the lines here correspond to mean square end-to-end distances between genomic loci on the simulated fibers, this one, and symbols refer to the same quantity, mean square end-to-end distances between genomic loci, but now on experiments, so real chromosomes, okay? And the different colors here are refer to different organisms. This is the red ones are on refer to yeast. The while these so this is human, this is human too, and this is a fruit fly, the Drosophila melanogaster. I mean the typical the common fruit fly. And what you can see here is that the simulation, this simulation, although they are somehow relatively simple, they are able to reproduce the, let's say, the average. They are able to reproduce the average conformation of chromosome that we really measure inside the cell. So you can somehow probe the typical structure of chromosome inside the cells. Another important observation that you can ask how frequently chromosome interact, in sense that you can measure how out the let's say the mean contact frequency between two loci on the same chromosome decays as a function of the genomic separation between them. So there is a consensus now that provided that the chromosomes are big enough, this law has to decay roughly as 1/L. So this is related to a particular structure of the chromosomes. And we found that our, the model is able to reproduce indeed this feature. So somehow, although it's very simple, this kind of coarse-grained computer simulation is able to capture the average behavior of chromosome in many different conditions and for many different organs. Okay, so of course this is not all of it. I mean, there are other features that that should be understood, but at least now with this model, you can somehow understand and tell something about the physics of the protist that gives birth to these chromosome territories. Maybe. I think I will, just tell you about a few things about this. So as I said to you, so here to formulate this model, we used a very, this is based on homopolymer structure. Of course, I mean, you can object saying that, okay, but chromosomes for sure are not homopolymers because there are, you have DNA sequence and so on and so forth. You have many proteins going around in nucleus. Of course, this is perfectly true. You are right. And so you can ask what it happens if I introduce noise in my model, in the sense that I use models, I mean, together, models with a different resolution, in the sense that some portion of my fiber are more condensed and some portion are less condensed. That was that we did a few years later. And we saw that, so I'm going a bit faster here. We saw that basically the model shows some stability, in the sense that on the larger scale, nothing really happens. What it happens, it really happens here on the small scale. And this, of course, I mean, it's quite important in the sense that we interpret that as a sort of stability of the chromosome and also of stability of the model. So we have something that works reasonably well on some scale, but I mean, on large scale. If on small scale something changes, this is of course perfectly acceptable, but then the overall structure remains stable. And since I think my time is a bit over, so I prefer to leave a few minutes for questions. I will, I leave this consideration out because it's a bit, maybe a bit more advanced, but I'm happy to answer your question if you have, if you are more curious about that. I just want to finish by acknowledging two people that worked with me on this, chromosome story. First of all, Ralf Evers, which with whom we started this work together many years ago now, more than 10 years ago. And Anna Maria Floresco was a postdoc with me in CISSA, and together with her, we developed this mixed fiber model for chromosome. And of course, since this is a numerical workshop, it's important to acknowledge HPC resources, because these simulations are quite intensive. So in particular, the TSM in Lyon, in Cineca in Italy, and also our local CISSA cluster here in CISSA. And with that, I think I've done. So I'm happy to take questions.
So if you want to ask a question, you can, I guess, unmute yourself and go ahead.
Can you hear me? Good. Hello, Angelo. Thanks for the talk. I was wondering, is it possible to model a change of methylation on the histones?
A change of methylation, yes. Well, it depends what you... so you want to somehow change the state, let's say, of your monomer somehow.
Yes, I would like to... Right. Yes. So I understand that you don't model the histones specifically, so you need to do that.
Yes. No. Yes. It's a very good question. Thanks for it. Yes. So there are actually there are already many a lot of work on that. I remember at least two groups now. Maybe there are more. There is work from the group of Edinburgh, of Davide Marenduzzo. I don't know if you know him. Davide has done a lot of work on that, where they assign a specific state to each monomer, let's say up and down, where you have a particular state of methylation, and you call state up, and a particular another state of methylation you call down. So it's a sort of spin system, okay? And this change dynamically in the course of the simulation, and in particular it's related to when these two spins, for instance, come together, they are allowed to change in order to see the spreading of the methylation on the chromosome. Otherwise there is also work, so this is an approach, and also there is work from the group of Andrew Spakovitz in it's in California, I think it's Caltech, yes. And so basically what they did, they also used polymer model. I think they did not study the spreading of methylation, but what they study, so they assume that somehow methylation is fixed, and they study what's the consequence of some specific proteins that attaches to the let's say, to the methylated states of the chromosome, and they see the consequence on the chromosome conformation. Okay, so in the end, yes, that can be done. Of course, there are certain assumptions, because then you have to, let's say, you have to assume how these things change. So in the end, the idea is that you formulate this simple assumption. You see that, for instance, if you can reproduce the methylation patterns of your specific cell, because of course they also change from cell line to cell line. Okay, so. But in the end, yeah, in principle, it can be done. Yes. About I don't know if I answered the question.
Sure. Yeah. About the first approach you mentioned, is it like an icing model?
It's like an icing model, yeah. Or even a POTS model, because maybe it depends how many states you assign. Okay, then it's a bit, of course, that it's relatively easy to change. So then what is important, the kind of rules you assign in order to change the state. In general, what they do, if I remember correctly, is that whenever two monomers come close to each other in space, either because they are close in space because they are close in sequence, or because they are close in space because just because of the random fluctuation of the fiber, you are allowed to change the to transmit, if you want, the methylation state of the event. And then, this kind of thing, because I mean, this fiber is very long, but then even if it's long, because you have a polymer, can come close to each other just because of the random clash. But in principle, it can be done, yes.
Cool, thank you.
Okay, I guess, well, there'll be time for more Q&A in the afternoon. So thank you very much, Angelo.